Well, I don't know. It might be in Maryland.
Yeah.
You did?
It's good to see 71. I saw it.
I like this.
What?
Let's stand and
worship the Lord this morning. It's so good to see everybody here. Hallelujah.
For those of you that survived last night's fellowship, praise the Lord.
Yes, we had a beautiful Christmas party at the home of the Bechtels. They opened up their home, their church, and we put 50 people in there. Praise the Lord. We had a great time.
Amen. Amen. It's time to praise the Lord. Are you ready?
Amen.
Let's get ready.
Yes.
Now are you ready?
Yes.
All right. Praise God. Hallelujah. Listen, our praise is not predicated on our circumstances.
Amen.
Our praise is not predicated even on our relationships with other people. Our praise is because He is God and we are not. And He deserves all of our praise. Amen. May your name be lifted high in this place today. May the Holy Spirit have His way. Hallelujah. May not only our lips praise you, but may it come from our very inner being, from the belly of our souls. May we bless the name of Jesus. May we praise Father God. May we let the Holy Spirit have His way. Oh, hallelujah. 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 Oh, hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord, for your many blessings. We ask now that you come and lead us in our time together right now in this meeting time. Oh, Jesus, if you come, everything's going to be all right. But if you have to stay away because of our attitude, because of how we conduct ourselves, it'll be the worst thing ever. Lord, help us get our minds and our hearts right, so that you can find a place here. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Ring the bells. Hallelujah. Let's come on, ring those bells for Jesus this morning. Glory to God. Hallelujah.
Jesus is a king, born for you and me.
To start stepping your game up a little bit, if you have to sing it, if you have to sing in Spanish, go ahead. sing in Spanish.
All right. I know. My Lord's going to lead us out. Whatever trouble we got ourselves into, God's going to lead us out of it. Let's sing it.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Man, we need a couple double A batteries up here.
Thank you.
so pretty.
I said we're getting there. Listen, Carol, I don't care. We can sing all day if we need to. I know you'd like that. Then you just shake hands with people and trade niceties. You're already back asleep. How is that possible? This reflexes.
Well, praise the Lord. I'm glad to be here. And if you want to open your bulletins and look on the wall, whatever is more convenient, we're so happy to be in the house of the Lord today.
Amen.
No place I'd rather be. Right here, right now. Praise God. Just some announcements, and then there's one announcement that's not in the bulletin, but it's very important. So for all of those of you that don't pay attention to the announcements in the bulletin, this will be good. Because it's not in there. Praise the Lord. So anyways, our weeks are, it's already December 4th, people. And just amazing. We were on our way to the Christmas fellowship time last night. And Matt was saying, didn't we just do this 2 weeks ago? That's what it felt like. It was just unbelievable. But anyway, it is what it is, and we're where we're at, so praise God. This week, our regular weekly ministries will be back here, Ladies Tuesday, and then Wednesday, full slate as we continue on. And now, we finally completed Romans 8, we'll be into Romans 9, and which is great and wonderful doctrinal stuff in Romans chapter 9. And come Wednesday night, if you want to know, how does Israel and the church, what is their relationship? Israel and the church. Some people think, you know, the church replaces Israel, which it does not. All right, some think they're always separate. And this is Romans 9 pretty much answers those questions. So Romans 9, this Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, everybody's welcome. Saturday evening, pray with pastor. And so tonight we're going to be I'm opening up a brand new series this month, and it's out of Isaiah 9. And we're gonna find out who Jesus is this month, all right? And you ought to know why you lit those lights, and you ought to know why you put the tree up, and you ought to know why they changed the music on the radio. You ought to know why that is. So we'll be talking about him this week, and that continues tonight. This morning, as is already in the bulletin, we're going to be preaching on Wonderful. And tonight, we'll be preaching on Counselor. And so you're not going to want to miss it. And we do want to, Deb has already mentioned it, but we do want to thank the Steve and Mary Bechtel? It was a spectacle at the Bechtels. Anyway, we did want to thank them for opening their home to us. And we were as happy as clams in a shell, because that's what we felt like. We were squeezed in there, but it was good eats, let me tell you. If you were not able to come, anyway, but it was really good eats. We also, I wanted to thank our new game master, Regina. She proved herself by how she played one of the games, and that's here. Thanks to Regina E.A. Ware. We're trying to guess the name, the Christmas songs, and on her name tag it was Regina E.A. Her name's Lee Ware. And then she said her song was the first Noel. See the Lees. Now you know you're a game master when you do something like that. So thank you, Regina. Tomorrow, next week, Sunday morning, our friends from Rochester, New York will be here, Final Harvest, and they're going to be giving a marvelous and anointed Christmas concert. And so you're going to want to, you feel free to bring someone with you, all right? This is probably the crazy preacher won't be preaching in the morning, so you would feel safer. And those of you that have heard, how many have never heard Final Harvest? Few of you, you're gonna like it.
Yeah.
How many have heard it and like them? All right, see? They're good. They're wonderful folks, and they're traveling throughout the Christmas season out here in the Southwest. Makes sense. Anyway, then this Saturday at 2 o'clock, this is not in the bulletin, that's why I'm sure you will remember it. This Saturday at 2 o'clock, all the kids, we need you right here. We'll be practicing for the Christmas program, which will be happening the 18th. It'll be happening the 18th. So we need all parents of you, or you can have, let your kids drive if you want to, but you need to make sure they get here. If you want to be famous, or at least notorious, let your children drive. But anyway, they'll be right here at 2 o'clock, and we'll have music. We'll be singing and then doing their program, so we'll be ready for the 18th. So here's the rest of December. No PM service on Christmas. And then on New Year's Eve, we do plan on having a service Saturday night, New Year's Eve, and a little fellowship time afterwards. And then the next day, which is Sunday, January 1st of 2017, we will not be having a PM service, okay? And then we'll be, just a reminder, we're on the, we have our own channel on YouTube. They've wiped everyone else out, and they just, big NVAG YouTube channel. You can always go there and find our services there. And we have them archived, and they're not quite live, but how many remember when they used to, when the Olympic Games are in a different country, they would still show the prime time here, it's a different time zone. Well, it's kind of like that on our YouTube. It's not quite live. Now, we are live, however, right now, and there's someone, probably one person, although Patty Cole is here today, thank God, but I could always count on her being one person that's watching this live. But we're thankful that you're here today, Patty. But we're also live on Facebook, and that also gets downloaded as well. Our contact information is there. Deb, is there anything else that I need to make the folks aware of? This is what's going to happen. We're going to take the offering, and then once the offering plate gets by you, those of you in our sign language class, I want you to make your way up here. It's time to take the tithes and offerings. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. What a privilege it is to invest in your kingdom, O God. Usually with investments, we expect to get something in return. But our return is in the souls of men and women and the blessings that we can have for them. I thank you, Lord Jesus, that you put us in this position to know your gospel, to believe your gospel, and also to spread your gospel. There's millions around this world that have never heard the good news of Jesus. There's people in our own neighborhoods that have never had a clear and concise witness of the gospel of Jesus. Help us to be your evangelist. Help us to go forward, Lord God, and spread the good news. Bless each one now that gives for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Sing with us, Deb, and I know, it just follows CC Blanca. It's all right. Don't worry. Amen. Are we ready? All right. Amen. Sing along with us.
Thank you.
Yeah.
sing, Father, we love you, we worship and adore you. Glorify thy name in all the earth. The Lord would say, in my presence is everything you need. In my presence is everyone you need. In my presence, there is peace that passes understanding. In my presence, no needs can remain. For I'm the answer. I am the answer. And in my presence is my answer for you, my dear child. Do not be filled with anxiety, neither be anxious this day. Know that as long as in your presence, you're in my presence, everything is already taken care of.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you,
Lord.
And adore.
Feel the dirt on his hands and on his feet so he'd know exactly what we've gone through so that he can meet every need according to the will of God. Hallelujah! He's not guessing how you feel. He knows how you feel.
Yes, he does.
I can't give but a few amens, Tim. He's not guessing what you're going through. He knows what you're going through. On the cross, he's already made provision to get you through those dark hours.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. talk about the only reason for Christmas. Not a reason, but the only reason for Christmas is Jesus Christ himself. Singular. I say it's singular. Build your snowmen if you want. No offense, Mary. She likes snowmen. Well, let me tell you, the only reason I've got to celebrate Christmas is Jesus himself.
Hallelujah!
I want to learn you some stuff this month. You must understand who he is. And I don't believe us preachers or teachers do an adequate job of sharing about who the person we call Jesus, or Jesus of Nazareth, or Christ Jesus, or the Master, or that. Who is he really? You must have a good definition of the personhood of Jesus Christ if you're going to understand being saved. If you don't understand who Jesus is, tough to get saved. If you think that he was just a teacher 2,000 years ago, you ain't going to get saved. You don't understand who he is. If you think he was just a prophet amongst other prophets, you're not going to get saved because you're not going to know who the real Jesus is. If you think he's some religious figure that helps you to get rich in this world, you're not going to make it because you don't know who the real Jesus is. First, you must understand that his being did not start in a stable outside of Bethlehem. It was much, much earlier than that. And some people cringe or they get... their understanding begins to leak out when they try to figure out who the Word is and who this Son is. And I'm telling you, the Bible indicates that it's Jesus, who we know as Jesus. In the first chapter of the Gospel of John chapter 1 and verse 1, begins to talk about this one that we know as Jesus or Jesus. Or Yahshua. In the beginning. In the beginning. In the very beginning of beginnings. Before there was anything else, there was the Word. And the Word was with God. The Father and the Son together. Father gave the command, the Son gave the word, and the Spirit executed it.
Hallelujah.
And the Word was God. Now this is where they stumble. They think, well, he's the Son of God. But how could he be? And we go into the Trinitarian. How'd you pronounce that? What is this Trinariton? Deb's reading Facebook, of course. The Trinariton. What is this? I go, show me the word. No, that's Trinitarian. Trinitarian idea, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Word is God.
Amen.
If you don't ever get that, if you don't get that about Jesus, you're in some cult.
Yeah, right.
If you think Jesus is the good twin brother of Satan, you're in a cult. If you think that he's anything other than the incarnate God, that means the God and man at the same time, you're in a cult because you don't got it. Understand, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the same was in the beginning. So when you go to Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, you see, you find that Jesus is in the beginning.
Right.
And Jesus is in the ending.
Hallelujah.
You got to know the real one. Are you there? Same was in the beginning. Verse 3 knocks the socks off people. They struggle with it. All things. Somebody say all things.
All things.
Were made by him.
Yes.
The reference isn't the word God. hymn, the hymn is not a reference to God, but a reference to the Word.
Amen.
All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. Every element on the periodic table was designed by Jesus, who we know as Jesus, the Word. Well, how do you know that? Well, because I read His book.
Yes.
And in Genesis chapter 1, God said, let there be light. That's the Word.
Yes.
Let there be light. Maybe you don't understand that, and you're worried about your mortgage. And you serve the One who said, let there be light. I want to ask you, have you ever looked up in the sky? I like Arizona because it's got lots of clear sky. Oh, I think up in the northern parts, I think the stars twinkle a little better. But that's because you're freezing your eyes off viewing the stars. I think they start to twinkle. Here, they're out a lot more because there's less clouds. And I want to challenge you to go out tonight after church and look up into the sky and see the stars and say, Jesus created every last
one. Yes, yes.
Glory. Glory.
Amen.
Now, because of my advanced age, my eyes are growing just a little dim. Right? And so, last night I went out and my lovely son and daughter-in-law allowed us to move their hot tub to our house. So now we have a hot tub. And in your advanced age, you come to appreciate that. Last night I was in the hot tub. I wore my glasses. Now this can be tricky. The colder it is, the more steam that thing produces. It fogs up your glasses. But last night I looked up and way up there. Now I usually don't wear glasses, so my star viewing is limited. Venus and Mars and that kind of thing. Orion's belt, we've got that and the Big Dipper. But last night I had my glasses on way up there and I saw this cluster. Some of you astronomers probably know. There's this cluster of stars way, they're all tiny to me, but they're all like clustered together. I said, oh, Jesus, you made that for some reason. And I don't know why, but Jesus, you created all of those things. Billions, some estimate trillions of stars. There was nothing that was made except Jesus commanded it into being. And you're worried about your mortgage.
Bless
him,
Jesus.
You serve the One who said, all right, we're going to make an armadillo. Who eats quesadillas? You serve the One who said, let's mess with them in Africa and grow them a giraffe.
Yes.
He made all of these things.
Praise God.
Now think of that. If that was within your power to say whatever you said, like, I want those melted, that beautiful whatever that's made out of, and it just melted immediately. And what if you said, now I'm going to create $1 million right here. Okay. You'd be pretty powerful. Right? You'd have friends. Jesus had that ability.
Yes.
Excuse me. Jesus has that ability. Now I'm not going to go over to the next line and say how much of that ability or authority has given us, but it's more than you think.
Right. Amen.
But think of that. The splendor. The earth is the Lord's and the glory, it's His. The big blue marble is His. and to turn to his Father and say, I give it all up.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah. All the credentials, all the power, all the glory, he gives it all up to become like you and me.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
He takes the glory, robe off. He takes the robe off where he created everything. He takes that off. He said, Father, I'll go. Those poor saps are never going to make it without me.
Praise God.
He takes it all off.
Hallelujah.
And then allows himself to become the seed of a woman.
Hallelujah.
And to be born of the flesh.
Hallelujah.
Merry Christmas.
Hallelujah.
Quickly turn with me to Isaiah 9:1. Isaiah 9:1. Get in the habit of bringing a Bible with you. If you cannot read, learn to read the books and the chapter notation so you can at least get there. And then underline whatever I read. Isaiah 9 and verse 1. This is a comeback. This is the comeback of Israel. Israel is in a detestable, horrible situation here. They're full of apostasy. They've got idols in every corner. And Isaiah is pronouncing judgment on them for that. But he's saying now in Isaiah 9, it's not going to last forever. Nevertheless, the dimness shall not be such as was in her vexation. When at the first he lightly afflicted the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, two tribes of Israel that were in northern Israel, Galilee. Afterward, did more grievous effect afflict her by the way of the sea, beyond Jordan and Galilee of the nations. You know, God will correct you lightly at first. Here's how my wife disciplined our children. She did it sometimes. Let's use my oldest, Andrew. Andy, get over here. No reaction. Andrew, James, you get over here right now. No reaction. Scott! One, two, Scott! It's like, did I do something wrong, Andy? But God, you see, tried to bring Israel back to himself by lightly afflicting them, by telling them, cut it out, come back to me, get rid of your idols. And when that didn't work, punitive actions had to take place, and they were heavier in order to get their attention. God never loves to punish his children. Never, ever, ever loves to punish them. But he'll do whatever he has to do to get their attention.
That's right, amen.
Even as it's to let them go captive into Babylon, burn Jerusalem down, tear the temple down, the whole 9 yards. He'll do whatever it takes to get their attention.
Yeah.
And we pray for them every week. Lord, Lord, tear their temple down then. Burn Jerusalem down. Whatever it takes for you to get their attention.
Yes.
Now, you don't get in the way of that. When God's in the midst of that, don't you get in the way.
Amen.
Verse 2, the people that walked in darkness. Here is, they're talking about northern Israel, Galilee, Capernaum. Those people that walked in darkness have seen a great light. Here prophecy comes about the sun. The word coming to this planet. And it said they have walked in darkness, but they have seen a great light. They that dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them has the light shined. I don't know if you've ever felt like you've been walking in the land of the shadow of death, but friends, there is a light that has come. Blessed be his name. Thou hast multiplied the nation and not increased the joy. They joy before thee according to the joy in harvest, and as men rejoice when they divide the spoil. It says something good is about to happen in Israel. Verse 4, for thou hast broken the yoke of his burden, and to them is the captivity. But to us, it's the burden of sin and the yoke that you must bear because of our sin. Because of my sin, I bear the yoke of my sin. But here, he has come to break that yoke off. And to break the staff of his shoulder and the rod of his oppressor, the devil himself and the old man in the flesh, to break the rod of his oppressor in the day of Midian. It was the Midianites that God called Gideon to conquer. And when all the odds were against Israel, he found a young man by the name of Gideon out behind the barn threshing wheat because the Midians kept stealing it. They kept burning their fields and he was making a little bit of grain. But in one day, I tell you, one day he was threshing grain out behind the barn. The next day he was a conquering hero as he chased the Midianites down and broke them down and killed them every last one until the sun went down the next day. I tell you, salvation comes like that. One day you're a dirty, rotten scoundrel, and the next day you've been purified by the blood of Jesus. For every battle of the warrior is with confused noise and garments rolled in blood. But this one, this battle is won, and it shall be with burning and fuel of fire. John the baptized you in water unto repentance. But there is one coming after me whose shoes latchet I am not worthy to unlatch. And when he comes, he will baptize you in the Holy Ghost and fire. He'll burn the chaff out. Oh, if somebody would help me, I could be good. Now we get to verse 6. For unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. I'll get there sometime this month. But let me tell you, the government's upon his shoulder.
Yes. Yes.
When you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you ask him to forgive you of your sins, he becomes your governor.
That's right.
Amen.
Yes. Don't worry about who the president is. Worry about who's your governor.
That's right.
Worry about who your governor is. Communism, socialism, democracy, a representative republic, of which we are. But who's your governor? Who sits upon the throne of your life? The government shall be upon his shoulder. Now his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God. The Mighty God, yes. The Everlasting Father. The Everlasting Father, yes. The Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end. Upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth. Anybody here, an English major, know what henceforth stands for? What it means, henceforth? From now and going forward. Henceforth, from now till going forth, even forever. You don't have to wait for the government of Jesus. It's here.
Hallelujah.
It's here, and it extends into eternity. And the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. How wonderful. This is what wonderful means. A marvel, a miracle, something, a mystery, hard to understand how it was done then. Jesus is wonderful.
Yes.
Amen.
You don't always understand it. You know why? Because he's smarter than you. You don't always understand his ways. You want to know why? Because he's wiser than you. You don't know how he meets your needs, but he does it anyways. Yeah, because he's bigger than you. Several songwriters, I think, have got it. Oh, how marvelous. Oh, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous.
Oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. A Sunday night song back in the day. Anybody here grow up with Assembly of God? Raise your hand, don't be ashamed. Well, we had this Melodies of Praise hymn book. Right? We sung out of this song book on Sunday morning. Victory in Jesus. Praise Him, praise Him. The old rugged cross. All of that's in here. Tis burning in my soul.
Yes.
Sunday night we started out singing from this one. But before long, and I don't have one on me, somebody here has one, there is a little chorus book that went along with the Melodies of Praise. And we pull that baby out. We begin to sing, wonderful, wonderful, Jesus is to me. Counselor, Prince of Peace, mighty God is He. Say to me, keeping me from all sin and shame. Wonderful is my Redeemer, praise His name. I said He's wonderful, wonderful, Jesus is to me. Counselor, Prince of Peace, mighty God is He. I'm saying it wrong. Saving me, keeping me from all sin and shame. Wonderful is my Redeemer, praise His name.
Yes, yes, yes.
They must have got, somebody started writing songs like it. His name is wonderful.
Yes.
His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He is the coming King. Master of everything, His name is wonderful, Jesus my Lord. Just when you thought it was over, then they go, He's the great shepherd, the rock of all ages, almighty God. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord.
He's Hallelujah.
He is the coming King and the Master. His name is wonderful, Jesus my Lord, for He's the great shepherd, the rock of all the ages, almighty God. Great songwriter put it like this. He rules the world with truth and grace, and He makes the nations prove the glory of wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders, wonders of his love.
We could go on and on today. He's wonderful. He's a little bit mysterious because he's so big and so smart. And you don't know how he always operates, you just know that he does. I mean, we call it being born again or the spirit. Maybe I already told you this. I know I told the Revival Center that the scientists have figured out that when an egg in the womb of a woman is fertilized, that a flash of light happens. Flash of light, light has begun.
Hallelujah.
Tell me about your just being a fetus or a mass of cells. The light of creation comes. Something happens, right? I'm not sure what happens, right? Right, but a new creature is made. And let me tell you, when a sinner falls to his knees and cries out to God, the great creator of everything, and says, "Oh Jesus, forgive me of my sin," there's a flash of light that takes place. For a new creature is made. Old things pass away and all things become new. A flash of light goes across all of heaven, and the angels begin to get up, and they begin to sing. There's a new name written down in glory. Hallelujah. Oh, Jesus is wonderful. I don't know what to really call it. We call it born again, but I don't know what that act of where this blood covers the sin, what really happens in that. I don't know what, if there's an English word for it. All I know is that it works, and it's worked for 2,000 years, and it's still working in the 21st century. I don't need to dilute this message up. I don't need to attack you with anything else but Jesus, and he's wonderful.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Whew. About ready to preach.
Come on now.
Why do songwriters say that Jesus is wonderful? Because it's true.
Yes.
Jesus was wonderful, Jesus is wonderful, and Jesus will always be wonderful. You see, when Jesus speaks or he does something, it makes you sit back and go, wow. Wow. Anybody here know what I'm talking about? We got to start over. Jesus ever made you go, oh, wow. Wow. You see, when he led Israel out of Egypt, you see, he was in the fire and he was in the pillar of the cloud. When he led Israel out of Egypt, he was wonderful. And it made him say, wow.
Yeah.
It made eventually, Pharaoh said, after uh-oh, wow, this God of Moses.
Glory.
When he led the next generation of Israelites across the Jordan River on dry land, he was wonderful.
Yes.
Mm. Let me tell you, somebody had to stack Jordan River up.
That's right.
Mm. He does the work. The Son does the work. How do I know it? I read his book.
Yes.
For before they crossed the Jordan, he came and visited Joshua.
Yes.
As the captain of the hosts of heaven. He says, "I'm for whoever obeys the Father. Are you going to obey him?" You know, Israel got beat up by a lot of folks. They went into apostasy. It was their own fault.
Right.
And they had been beat up, overtaken, enslaved, let go, enslaved again, and now they're in the midst of the Roman Empire, being annexed by the Roman Empire. Kind of like what Phoenix does up in New River and Anthem. They just keep annexing things. And the Roman Empire had annexed Israel. And it was a down time for Israel. But something wonderful was about to happen. the wonderful Son.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Oh, the child from heaven had been born, and everything now is about to change. Suddenly, the darkness, the shadow of death, the pall of death that hung over Israel was about to be blown out of the water by the light of the world. Everything in Israel is about to change because the light had shown up in the midst of the darkness. The yokes of bondage had to be broken off because the deliverer was now intact. While walking on this earth, Jesus did so many wonderful things. But we, just for the record, someone asked me this week, do they celebrate Christmas in heaven? This is so profound what Jesus told Dr. Eby. It's all in my book, if you'd like to read it. Do they celebrate Christmas in heaven? Did they celebrate the first Christmas? All right, there's your answer. Are you kidding me? The stars
clap their hands.
Rejoice that the light has come.
Hallelujah!
The planets align themselves and bow.
Right.
Yes.
Put little ribbons on themselves. Oh, yes. If I'm in heaven, we're going to celebrate Christmas.
Right.
It was actually my oldest sister asked me that. And I go, she goes, I wonder if Mom celebrates Christmas in heaven. I go, are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? They know how to celebrate Christmas.
Oh, yeah.
It won't be with a couple lights hanging on the house either.
Right.
When Jesus walked on this planet, he did so many wonderful things. Ask that poor widow woman. They're walking down the road. And Jesus and disciples are on over here, and they're like, what's going on over there? And the woman under the pressure and the weight of grief and sorrow is walking beside the, I don't know, what do they call it, briar or whatever. In our language, it would be casket of her only son. She's a widow. She has one son, and he's dead. And Jesus, the light of the world, is in town. And he could have walked by,
yes,
but he didn't. He could walk by you too, but he's not going to.
Hallelujah.
He walks up to that woman and said, what seems to be the problem here? I'm a widow, and this is my only boy. And now he's dead, and we're on our way to bury him. This is not so quick. Not so quick. And Jesus did something you should never do as a Jew, and that is touch the briar that somebody dead was on. But the millisecond that Jesus touched it, he didn't break the law. Life came back. I said, when Jesus touches something, life comes. Wow. And then his mom said, wow, you must be wonderful. Life rushed back into that body. I'm telling you, Jesus became wonderful to a ripoff artist by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a scoundrel of scoundrels. Worked for the IRS. But when the wonderful one came to town, he could have passed by Zacchaeus,
yes,
in the sycamore tree, but he didn't.
Yeah.
And in your lost state, he might pass by you,
but he won't.
Thank you, Jesus.
He said, Zach, let's go have some lunch. And the minute Mr. Wonderful walked into Zacchaeus' house, the light had come where darkness had used to reign, where money was everything in that house. Sunlight became as nothing. And light came into Zacchaeus and changed everything about him. You see, when Jesus walks in your house, everything gets right in a hurry.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Jesus has done a lot of wonderful things. Ask a little lady by the name of Mary Magdalene. Magdalene, that's where she lived. And Jesus is walking through there. And he looks over, and here's this woman. She could have been pretty, but she had a devil all over her. Her eyes were sucked into her head. Dark, dark, dark circles under her eyes. Her hair was a mess. Clothes disheveled. Out of the way. She had to stay out of the way. Some people say the only way she had to make money is to sell her body. And Jesus came walking by that poor wretch of a woman. And he could have kept walking, but he didn't.
Hallelujah. Glory.
The wonderful one said, young lady,
glory.
What is your problem? She goes, I don't know, but it's not good. And seven times he said, come out, come out, come out. And those demons fled out of her body. And when the second they were gone, Mary Magdalene became the most devoted disciple that, in my studies, the most devoted disciple that I've ever heard of. Never left him. She never left him in the trials, in the beatings, at the cross. She showed up everywhere. After he was dead, she showed up in his tomb, friends. Because she knew, it's wonderful. He knew there was nobody like him. He's wonderful. And if he was wonderful before he died, after he died and rose again, he's even more wonderful today.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. Jesus.
What about that guy at the pool?
Uh-huh.
He's so tan. 30 years of tanning by the pool.
Yeah.
But he had not gotten what he needed. 38 years. That's two careers for some of you. 38 years. And I know some are critical of this guy. Why didn't you do something different? Why didn't you get your family around and pay somebody some money to throw you in first? I don't know. Maybe he didn't have anything because he was lame. He was a cripple. Maybe he didn't have much family. It didn't seem like his parents were that excited that he could walk. But anyway. All these people on the five porches were waiting, and Jesus comes up and he ignores everybody except this one guy. He doesn't walk by. He said, how come you're here? You know, Jesus is funny. How come you ain't seen these shriveled up old eggs? I got nothing, man. And every time I try to get into that pool, somebody beats me. I get wet a lot, but I never get healed. I wonder if there was like some close calls, like in the Olympics, you know, they just out-touched the other one. I wonder if it was like, he just got in there just a millisecond before. I wonder if anyone drowned. Like if they were all crippled up and they jumped in second. All right, I'm sorry. Apologize for that. I accused my wife of thinking too much. Jesus says, you know, I'm wonderful, and today's your day. You don't have to wait for the water. The light is here. Stand up. Take your bed.
Hallelujah.
I don't have time to talk about his walking on the water, or feeding thousands with a handful of food, or healing thousands from countless diseases, even getting money out of that fish's mouth.
yet he, in him being so wonderful. And I don't have time, and I'm really close to being done here. I don't want to keep you all afternoon. He was so wonderful. The most wonderful thing he did was he submitted himself to cruel, hateful people so that he could for the sins of people everywhere, including me. And you, now, it's one thing if you're a beggar to begin with. It's one thing if you've never had anything, right? But when you've commanded light to be, you've commanded the fish in the sea, you've commanded everything into being that there was, you already know everything there is to know. I'll talk more about that tonight. And you allow yourself to be spit on, your beard tugged, cursed, made fun of, mocked, lied about, and you let it happen. Then you let them beat you to a pulp, and then you let them hang you on a cross. You have to let them.
That's right.
Because if Jesus let guards down even a little and let his flesh come out and commanded something, it would have been done like that.
Right.
He had to let that all go and humble himself because he saw you 2,000 years later in need of someone who had the ability to wash away your sin. You've heard all the songs that did, if I was the only one, and you know they're right.
Amen.
I don't understand that kind of love. That's why he's Mr. Wonderful and I'm not. I don't comprehend that kind of grace. But he did it. Jesus is still doing wonders today. He still wows us today. He's as wonderful today as he's ever, ever been. How do I know? Because I'm looking at him. I'm looking at people, his wonders to perform. He's done some wonderful things in you, for you, and with you. And he's got more ready to produce through you. He's got wonderful things to produce through you and me. He has not given up on this country. He has not given up on this planet. If he had, if he's done, then he'd already be here.
Right.
As long as he's not here yet, he's got hope for it. He's going to work his wondrous works until the trumpet sounds.
Yes. Yes.
Hallelujah.
He's working in your life right now. He's working in my life right now. Glory to God. About a week and a half ago, I got saved again. You know, it's like, He began to show me stuff in the Bible. It's like, now, come on, I preached that 20 years now, and right now it's just like you understand what that means? When those words become a reality in your life, they're more than a sermon, they're more than a lesson, they become reality. Hallelujah. The reality of his wonders are the elements here. His broken body is shed blood. There ain't nothing that can get by the body and blood of Jesus
Hallelujah.
Christ.
Hallelujah.
Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
I gotta stop. It's afternoon. We're going to start at 10 o'clock someday. So I won't get here so quick. But Jesus, in his blood and his body, not only has made provision for us, but you get vision through that. Start to look at yourself through his blood and through his body. The devil wants you to look at yourself like you've always looked at yourself, fat or skinny or ugly or dashingly handsome or whatever. But begin to look at what Jesus has done for you. I don't know of any other, quote, religion. Every other religion I know is that you've got to come and bow to whatever it is. But we got the wonderful one. And he comes in to us. Is this not a wonderful thing?
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
He doesn't ask us to go to Mecca, nor the Wailing Wall in Jerusalem, in order to get him. He said, I will come to you.
Thank you, Jesus.
I will come to you. He came to that lame man by the pool of Bethesda. He came to that poor widow with the dead son. He came to all these people, and he's come to you. He's come to me. I have no idea how you turn him down. I don't have a comprehension how you turn that down. To let the wonderful one in. Listen, sir, listen, ma'am. If you're not right, you're not right with God today. The wonderful one is here. His arms are open, and he's calling you to himself. If you're sick here today, the wonderful one is here, and he's calling you to himself. If you're confused today, if you don't know which way to turn, if you're between a rock and a hard place, the one who is called Wonderful is here. He's here. He'll do what needs to be done on your behalf if you'll let him. I'm going to ask the brethren to come. We're going to receive the elements. You do not need to be a member of this church to share with us, but you do need to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. The Bible is very explicit about taking communion outside of fellowship of Jesus. It's very dangerous. It leads to sickness and death. And he's not fooling. But begin to see yourself through his body and through his blood today. I'm telling you, the wonderful one's going to make everything be all right.
Scott's gonna sing it.
Stretched out,
of Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Broken for each one of us. So that we might be whole. You know, in the old days, they used to make those perfume bottles. Put them out in, and it had no top. The only way the aroma was going to leave was if you broke it. That's why Judas was so angry. When Mary Magdalene broke open that bottle of perfume, $500 to him was down the drain. Jesus had to be broken in order to get that sweet smelling savor out that would take away the sin of men and women all over the world. See, sin is a stench in the nostrils of God. And I can't cover it up. There's no facade I can create that'll make it okay. Only Jesus, through his broken body.
That's right.
We thank you, Lord, for your broken body.
Thank you, Jesus.
And I tell you today, we are not ashamed to be called your own. And so we partake of this bread as the symbolism of your broken body that was broken for us, that we might live forever in wholeness. Let us eat together. Gallons of blood that was spilt in the Old Testament could not take away, would only appease God's wrath, could not take away the sin. That's why everybody's got to come through Jesus. Everybody, including Abraham, has to come through Jesus. Jesus' blood sprinkled upon the great throne room, upon the mercy seat, was enough. It was enough for you. It was enough for me. We read it Wednesday night. He who spared not his own son, but gave him up for us, how shall he not also freely provide us with every other thing that we need? My Jesus, the wonderful one. Let us partake of this cup that represents his shed blood for you and me. Thank you, Jesus.
His name is wonderful.
You have a wonderful day in the Lord. We'll be back here at 6 o'clock this evening.